With a new generation of graphics cards slowly crowning before our very eyes, and with it the solidifying realization that because of AI, from now on games are just gonna kinda look terrible. I see you're real impressed with these graphics. You see, because of AI upscaling, we can use ray tracing to realistically shimmer light off the hood of this car. And the only downside of the upscaling is some slight smearing, but I'm sure you can't tell. Like with this Neural Faces showcase, for example, breaking the uncanny valley. What do you mean? This lady's teeth are phasing all over the place. How do you think this looks better? But anyway, this is the point of the video. Calm down, let's not let my heart explode again. So instead of getting mad, I'm gonna do a retrospective celebrating a couple of revolutionary graphics technologies that's led us to the AI slop that we're faced with today. But first, today's video is sponsored by Micro Center, which is the place to buy some new RTX 5000 action, which not only has, quote, the best selection of RTX 5080 and 5090 GPU models, but they also have a GPU trade-in program where you can trade in working graphics cards that you bought at Micro Center, giving you same-day graphics card valuation. And what I find most exciting is that Micro Center has a new program that helps you recycle old and out-of-date tech, which is another great reason to check out the new up-and-coming Santa Clara Micro Center. Links for everything down below. Thank you, Micro Center, for sponsoring today's video. And to kick things off, we're starting with tessellation. Now, as somebody who was bullied as a child by a low polygon flat surface texture, I personally love tessellation. Yes, yes, burn it all down! Now, tessellation is basically asexual reproduction for polygons. It takes the polygons that makes up objects in the rendered image, splitting them into smaller pieces, increasing the polygon count of the object. Now, playing some Barry White until the triangles that make up an object reproduces doesn't magically create more detail. That's why tessellation is used with displacement mapping, which is a texture that stores height information. So you can use the extra triangles to either smooth or create depth in the object, taking your flat loser floors and making them all realistically cobbly. Now, tessellation has been around in some form for ages. The first graphics card supporting it, the ATI Radeon 8500, was launched back in August of 2001. ATI called the technology Trueform, and they patched it into a couple of games like Counter-Strike. Look at how round it made those helmets. But apparently developers hated using it because you had to design your models with Trueform in mind, otherwise it would look terrible, which, you know, I guess, like, fair enough. But for most of the examples that I saw, it did actually look quite a bit better with Trueform on. But regardless, it didn't take ATI long to abandon Trueform. However, ATI's love for round helmets burned deep, and in 2007, ATI tried again with TerraScale, which used DirectX 10 features, but again, ATI failed to seduce the developers, I think partly because it wasn't an official DirectX 10 feature, and it doesn't help that ATI was late to the DirectX 10 knife battle, a knife battle that Nvidia was very much winning with its legendary 800 series of GPUs. The 8800 GTX was too busy dominating the industry and making loud, passionate love to Crysis for it to care about little ATI toys. But then, Microsoft officially added tessellation to DirectX 11, I think at least partially due to the ATI graphics in the Xbox 360. The problem was, the TerraScale 1 GPUs didn't support DirectX 11 tessellation, which is a little bit of a bummer, but AMD's TerraScale 2 GPUs did, making them the first graphics cards to support a form of tessellation that developers didn't just want to abandon at the side of the road like an iPad baby. Which seems like a huge win for ATI and then AMD, but it did backfire on them a little bit, because at this point, Nvidia entered the chat, and their first hardware tessellation graphics card, the GTX 480, which aside from its tendency to LARP as a steel foundry, dumpstered AMD graphics cards at tessellation, which honestly is quite disrespectful. ATI and then AMD spent a decade trying to herald in this new technology just to get curb stomped by Nvidia using it. But at least ATI's sacrifice got us a metric butt-ton of polygons in our cobbled floors, which is kinda nice. So the next time you hear Unreal Engine bragging about their nanite tessellation implementation making games look even more realisticer, spare a thought for the ATI engineers and their dolphins. But anyway, with that, we're getting into the next technology. Now, in this video, I'm not going to be able to cover that many. So subscribe to the channel if you want me to turn this into a video series. Let me know down below. But anyway, the next revolutionary graphics technology is ambient occlusion. If you also get off on soft, luxurious shadows in all of your game images, cracks and creases, you're also a fan of ambient occlusion. Basically, ambient occlusion is an advanced shading technique that allows for more detailed shadows from ambient light. Before ambient occlusion, games would just use shadow mapping, which renders the image from the perspective of the light, and everything that the light can see is lit, and everything that the light can't see in the scene is in shadow. Now this works pretty well, but it's very one-dimensional because it doesn't take ambient lighting into account. So you get the obvious hard shadows, but you don't have the little bits of shadow on a complex object that adds depth and contrast to the image. Now, this is all very complicated, but basically, here's a scene using just normal shadow mapping, and here's a scene using ambient occlusion to complement the shadow mapping. You can see there's quite a bit more contrast in this image because of all of the little shadows in places. Now you can fake this with like texture coloring and stuff, but then it's not dynamic. Here's an example of that. Somebody added shadows to Half-Life 1, which it was part of the engine apparently, but they turned it off when they launched the game, and you can turn it back on. That's a story for a different time. Basically, they turned shadows on in Half-Life, and you can see that the main shadows react realistically to the light source. But when it comes to the shading on their model, like the little bits of shirt and stuff, that looks shaded, but that's through texture coloring, it's not dynamic. Like the one guy facing the light has the same shading on his shirt as the guy facing the opposite direction. Now, as is always the case with this kind of stuff, there's a bunch of different types of ambient occlusion. The first one that you'd find in games was called screen space ambient occlusion, which the explanation is this is how it works. I don't think I understand that. It has something to do with pixels comparing their depth information to the pixels around them to figure out how occluded they need to be. And then some magic happens which leads to shadows. And apparently the problem with that is that it basically just works like edge detection. It darkens areas where objects meet each other, which leads to weird halos and stuff. And then they upgraded from that to ground truth ambient occlusion, which I think has something to do with spoken word slam poetry, I'm not sure. And then eventually, as graphics cards got more powerful, they introduced ray tracing ambient occlusion, which uses ray tracing to figure out where the shadows needs to be, which is obviously the most realistic, but it's also the most power intensive, although it's still not nearly as demanding as global illumination. It kind of approximates global illumination with trickery, I guess. What's interesting about researching this stuff is there's like the surface level depth around all of these techniques used to explain to normies like me more or less what the technology does, but the moment that you go any deeper than that, you're just in the depths of how the Unity engine functions, and it gets very complicated very quickly, but it makes the games look better. It's good, it's an improvement. Shadows are nice. Now, as far as I can tell, there isn't some wild story behind the invention of ambient occlusion. The first game that implemented real-time ambient occlusion was Crysis, and Crysis is one of the biggest graphical leaps ever. I'm not saying it's because of ambient occlusion, but it definitely played a role, and it was a great way to sell the technology. I mean, just look at how much more terrified this North Korean soldier looks because of that shadow under his jaw. Which brings me to the end of the video. Thank you very much for watching. Subscribe if you found the video interesting, and until the next one, bye-bye.